are listening to 106.7, Wilmington's Big Talker, and my name is Paul Vallone. I'd like to welcome you to Guns, Politics, and Freedom, where each Sunday at 5 p.m., as part of the Sunday Night Political Power Block, we give you the ammunition to better defend your gun rights. In case you aren't familiar with me, I direct Grassroots North Carolina, since 1994, our state's most effective gun rights organization. As its director, I was involved in drafting and passing our original concealed handgun law and numerous enhancements since then. Grassroots North Carolina is exactly what the name implies, a grassroots collection of people from all walks of life who share a common concern that our constitutionally guaranteed freedoms are being eroded. Check us out at grnc.org. That's grnc.org. Today, our featured guest will be renowned gun rights lawyer David B. Koppel of the Independence Institute. In addition to authoring numerous books, including my favorite, The Samurai, the Mountie, and the Cowboy, Should America Adopt the Gun Controls of Other Democracies, David's amicus briefs were cited in decisions for both seminal cases on the Second Amendment, namely D.C. versus Heller and McDonald versus Chicago. He has been instrumental in charting the course of the Second Amendment in the courts, and today David will discuss the impact of recent Supreme Court refusals to hear cases which could establish constitutional protections for both semi-automatic firearms and bearing arms outside the home. But first, let's discuss recent gun rights news. You heard it here first, the Mossberg Shockwave and shotguns like it are now, at least for now, legal in North Carolina. For those who haven't heard of the Shockwave, it is a short-barreled shotgun which does not have a shoulder stock, sort of like the old Mossberg Cruiser, but much shorter due to a barrel length of only 14 inches. Remember, short-barreled shotguns, namely those with barrels of less than 18 inches, are regulated by the National Firearms Act of 1934, along with machine guns, short-barreled rifles, sound suppressors, and destructive devices. Consequently, owning one requires filing extensive paperwork with a BATFE, including a background check, paying a $200 tax stamp, waiting 6 months or more for approval, and being subject to continuing scrutiny. So imagine our surprise when the ATF determined that the Shockwave is not a firearm for purposes of the National Firearms Act. Yes, it is still a firearm for other federal laws, just not for the NFA. Their apparent reasoning is that despite having a 14-inch barrel, the fact that the gun has a bird's head grip in lieu of a shoulder stock makes it apparently legal. So this nifty little toy is legal without any of the bureaucratic nonsense. The problem is that although the Shockwave was legal under federal law, it was unknown whether it could be prohibited under North Carolina state law by virtue of being classified here as a weapon of mass death and destruction. Nonetheless, even absent a clear determination, the guns have been selling like hotcakes, potentially making felons of otherwise law-abiding gun owners. Enter Forsyth County Sheriff William Schatzman, who sent a letter asking the state's attorney general whether the gun was legal for sale here. Initially, I said, uh-oh. After all, our Attorney General, Josh Stein, is no friend of gun rights. So imagine my further surprise when Special Deputy Attorney General J. Joy Strickland, on November 5th of this year, sent Schatzman a letter saying that, while yes, under North Carolina General Statutes 14288.8, the Shockwave is indeed a weapon of mass death and destruction for purposes of our statutes, however, it is also included in the list of exceptions to the general prohibition in owning such weapons and is therefore legal. You see, there's a list of exceptions, including governmental contractors, people doing research, dealers, and some more stuff. This is an archaic statute. And which exception to the general prohibition applies here, making the gun legal? According to Strickland, it is 14288.8B5, which says, persons who lawfully possess or own a weapon as defined in subsection C of this section in compliance with 26 U.S. Code, Chapter 53, subsection 5801 to 5871. Essentially, that is, anybody approved by the BATFE to own such firearms. Now, finally, the grand irony. The one who wrote the language for 14288.8B5 was yours truly. Yep, Grassroots North Carolina inserted that language into House Bill 650 for Castle Doctrine way back in 2011 in order to resolve a discrepancy in statutes having to do with legally owned machine guns. So it was that Grassroots North Carolina made the Mossberg Shockwave legal, at least for now, in North Carolina. Now on to the good news, bad news front. The good news is that, as you may have heard, the U.S. House last week passed the National Concealed Handgun Reciprocity Bill in a resounding 231-198 vote, with 6 Democrats voting in support of the bill. In its present form, this bill, sponsored by North Carolina's own Congressman Richard Hudson, Republican of Concord, would allow concealed handgun permit holders, plus citizens from other states that do not require permits to lawfully carry concealed handguns, to do so anywhere they may lawfully do so in the United States. You know, there are some state and federal restrictions, obviously. Clearly, that represents a step forward for gun rights. The bad news is that in a deal apparently brokered by the NRA, the House also combined into the bill the contents of its version of the so-called Fix NICS legislation, NICS being the National Instant Background Check System, the computerized background check system, which, you will recall, the Fix NICS language in the Senate was the progeny of none other than Senators Dianne Feinstein, Chuck Schumer, and the usual crowd of anti-gunners, plus a smattering of Republicans in a so-called bipartisan agreement. Now, this has caused some division in the gun rights community. In fact, Representative Thomas Massie, Republican of Kentucky, the head of the Congressional Second Amendment Caucus, now opposes the bill, recommending that we oppose any bill which includes the Fix NICS language. Similarly, Gun Owners of America, the Firearms Coalition, and others have come out against the combined bill. On the other hand, even some stalwarts like Mark Walters of Armed American Radios have come out in favor of passing the combined bill. Yes, on AmmoLand.com, an excellent news clipping service, by the way, in a piece called Who's Afraid of the Big Back Bad Fix NICS, Walter says he doesn't like the bill, but he doesn't feel we should kill it just because it contains the Fix NICS language. He correctly debunks some of the common fallacies and notes that it would not add any new classes of prohibited people to the list of those barred from buying guns. But I would ask Walters to note a couple of things. First, there is no way in hell that Schumer and Feinstein will let the Senate pass any bill containing national reciprocity. Republicans don't have enough votes to override a Democrat filibuster. So when the Senate passes only the Fix NICS language, and then the Senate and House versions go to conference committee, rest assured it will come out only with the Fix NICS language, as the politicians apologetically explained that it's the best we could do, maybe next time. And with respect to the fact that Fix NICS only includes financial incentives for more comprehensive reporting and doesn't include any new prohibited classes of people, remember that in the so-called NICS Improvement Act of 2007 didn't include any new prohibited classes either, yet in its wake, more than 260,000 veterans with post-traumatic stress disorder were barred from ownership when, under Obama, the Veterans Administration reported them to NICS. Equally, Obama wanted to report tens of thousands of Social Security recipients, a scheme which was only reversed by Donald Trump. So anybody who tells you that new classes of people won't be added, tell them there is plenty of maneuvering room to bar gun rights from hundreds of thousands of people who might or might not be prohibited persons. The low-hanging fruit, by the way, being those who pled decades ago to some minor misdemeanor after a fight with their spouse just to make the charge go away and would now be guilty of misdemeanor crimes of domestic violence. So I just suggest you call your congressman and both U.S. senators and tell them to oppose any bill which contains the Fix NICS language. In a moment, we're going to take a short break, but first I would like to discuss an invaluable service to those of us who carry firearms for self-protection. The world is a dangerous place. That's why we prepare to defend ourselves and our families. After we've won the physical fight, however, there's also the legal fight. Prepare yourself to win the legal fight with LawOfSelfDefense.com. Attorney Andrew Branca at lawofselfdefense.com helps educate law-abiding citizens to minimize their risk of prosecution in civil suit. He translates the legalese into plain English so you can make more confident, better-informed decisions when acting in self-defense. Now, for a limited time, you can get 20% off the legal education offered by lawofselfdefense.com using the discount code GPF, as in Guns, Politics, and Freedom, at checkout. Just point your browser to lawofselfdefense.com/GPF. That's lawofselfdefense.com/GPF. Meanwhile, you are listening to Guns, Politics, and Freedom on Wilmington's Big Talker, 106.7 WilmingtonBigTalker.com. Join us after the break when we resume with David Koppel and his read on recent Supreme Court developments. My name is Paul Vallone, and you are listening to Guns, Politics, and Freedom today on Wilmington's Big Talker, 106.7, WilmingtonBigTalker.com. Today, our guest is nationally renowned Second Amendment attorney David B. Koppel. In addition to being the research director at the Independence Institute and adjunct professor of advanced constitutional law at Denver University Sturm College of Law, David is the author of The Truth About Gun Control, No More Wacos, What's Wrong with Federal Law Enforcement and How to Fix It, Antitrust After Microsoft, The Samurai, the Mountie, and the Cowboy, Should America Adopt the Gun Controls of Other Democracies? That, by the way, I have used that resource many, many times, and no less than 9 other books. His articles have been published in the Denver Post, the Washington Post, the Los Angeles Times, the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and in law review articles, including the Harvard Law Review, Yale Law Journal, and a number of others. In 2008, David appeared before the United States Supreme Court as part of the team presenting the oral argument in the landmark Second Amendment case, District of Columbia versus Heller. His Heller amicus brief for a law coalition of law enforcement organizations and district attorneys was cited 4 times in the court's Heller opinions. His brief in the other landmark Second Amendment case, McDonald versus Chicago, which further established the individual right to bear arms. He was cited by Justice Alito's plurality opinion and twice by Justice Stevens' dissent. He was also testified numerous times before Congress and state legislatures, including the U.S. Senate Judiciary Committee on the Supreme Court nominations of Elena Kagan and Sonia Sotomayor. Welcome, David, to Guns, Politics, and Freedom.
No, thanks for having me.
Now, by the way, I should note here that one of your first papers, I think, was the assault weapons panic. Was that one of the first?
That was a very early one. That was back in 1989, I think.
That was actually one of my first and great sources when I first started becoming involved in the movement in the early 1990s. As I recall, wasn't that paper the one in which you outed Josh Sugarman and his memo on semi-automatic firearms?
Well, it wasn't out. I mean, yeah, I certainly cited it and talked about it. It wasn't where he. This is the strategy memo he wrote for the anti-gun movement, which in 1987, which essentially said the public and the press are they're bored with handgun bans. They're not interested. We need something new. Let's do assault weapons. And one of the big advantages for us on this is the public will think if it looks like a machine gun, it is a machine gun. But that was not some, you know, secret memo that somebody leaked to me. That was a publicly available document. And to Sugarman's credit, that's on his, you know, on his group's website today.
Oh, I didn't realize it was. Well, that pretty much has summed up their strategy for the last 3 decades, I guess.
Yeah.
Anyways, so today I'd like to talk about the recent Supreme Second Amendment scholarship, particularly with reference to cases accepted or denied by the Supreme Court. After Heller and McDonald, gun rights activists figure we would have it pretty much smooth sailing, but that hasn't exactly been the case, has it?
Well, no, sorry, not as smooth as I think some people imagined. I think some people had this kind of fantasy that once you get the right established, that everybody's going to fall in line with strong protection of the right. And that has been true certainly for some some judges, but definitely not for all, and certainly not always consistently in the Supreme Court. And and that's true, been true historically on other things. I mean, the First Amendment we have today didn't spring into being like Venus on the half shell arriving as a mature adult a few weeks after the Supreme Court in the 1920s and early 1930s first recognized the First Amendment as a meaningful right.
Okay. But recently the Supreme Court has declined to take a number of cases,
right.
one of which had actually been ours here in North Carolina, and Alan Gura contacted me way back when for the case that eventually became Bateman versus Purdue over our state of emergency gun ban, which banned completely dangerous substances outside the home during declared states of emergency.
Right.
As I say, unfortunately, on that one, we won, and the state chose not to appeal, so it never went.
Don't complain about that. Everybody has this fantasy of they're going to get to the Supreme Court, and, when Alan Gore was starting McDonald versus Chicago, that was one where you could really say, we've got a real strong chance of getting certiorari on this. But in general, it's better to win your case on the merits and bank that victory rather than thinking you're going to be able to parlay a loss into a Supreme Court cert grant.
Yeah, so noted. And we did actually go back the following year and repeal the now unconstitutional state of emergency gun ban, so
right.
That restriction is gone entirely, I'm happy to say. But how about some of these other cases that have come to the Supreme Court that they've declined to take? Tell us a little bit about some of those and what they why and just generally what the Supreme Court has declined to deal with.
Well, since McDonald versus Chicago, the Supreme Court has taken one case involving Second Amendment issues, and that was the Massachusetts ban on stun guns, electric self-defense devices, a case called Caetano versus Massachusetts. And there the court did what's called a grant, vacate, and remand, which is they granted the cert petition, said we do not need oral argument or anything else or briefing or anything else on this. This decision is obviously ridiculous, and we reverse it and send it back to the Massachusetts Supreme Judicial Court. And next time you consider Massachusetts Supreme Judicial Court, why don't you think about our precedents like you should have done the first time? Because the Massachusetts court had, and this was a 9-0 decision by the U.S. Supreme Court, the Massachusetts Supreme Court had said, well, you can ban stun guns because, first of all, they didn't exist when the Second Amendment was written, and besides that, they're not really much use in a militia. And the Supreme Court said, did you read the Heller decision? We said you don't have your arms bearing doesn't have to be connected to a militia to be part of the Second Amendment. And we also said the Second Amendment isn't limited to the technology that existed in 1791. So the court did not hold that the stun gun ban was unconstitutional. It simply said the Massachusetts court's reasoning was defective.
I see. Okay.
So that was the unanimous court. And then I think it was Alito and Thomas wrote a concurrence saying we totally agree with, we're part of the nine that definitely agrees the Massachusetts decision was way out of line. But we should have just affirmatively said, of course, there's a right to possess this Ms. Caetano, who was being stalked by her ex-husband, and used a stun gun when he attacked her because she didn't want to kill the father of her children. That they would have said yes, and that, and they would have affirmatively said stun guns are within the Second Amendment right, and Ms. Caetano had a right to carry a stun gun for lawful defense. The majority didn't go that far, but the majority simply said Massachusetts, try another time to think about it. So that's still going on in Massachusetts. New Jersey, meanwhile, and Washington, D.C. have, I think, taken the spirit of the Caetano decision and repealed their stun gun bans.
Okay. All right. And so that's one case they took. How about some of the cases they haven't taken? Peruta, for example, or some of the other ones?
Yeah, there are sort of two broad categories of cases they haven't taken, one of which was denied about a week ago, Colby versus Hogan, which is a case I was involved in. I wrote an amicus brief on the pro-Second Amendment side on behalf of the National Sheriff's Association, you know, the organization which since the, I think, the 1940s has represented America's sheriffs, and they strongly opposed Maryland's ban on magazines over 10 rounds and ban on so-called assault weapons.
David, I'm gonna pick up on that one after our break, because we're gonna have to take a break here. But I want to hear all about that one. And Colby is a very significant decision, I think. So I do want to hear all about that. Meanwhile, folks, you are listening to Guns, Politics, and Freedom today on Wilmington's Big Talker, 106.7 WilmingtonBigTalker.com. Please join us after the break when we resume with our guest David Kopel and his read on recent Supreme Court developments. My name is Paul Vallone, and you are listening to Guns, Politics, and Freedom today on Wilmington's Big Talker, 106.7, WilmingtonBigTalker.com. Today we have as our guest renowned Second Amendment attorney David Kopel of the Independence Institute. David, you were telling us about Colby versus Hogan and, you know, essentially the where that's going to lead us. Please continue, if you would.
So, as we're saying, I wrote the amicus brief for the in support of the cert petition in Colby versus Hogan, the Maryland ban on magazines over 10 rounds and on so-called assault weapons. The Supreme Court denied cert in that case in late November, as they similarly denied cert in Friedman versus Highland Park, an earlier case from the Seventh Circuit that had challenged a Chicago suburbs similar ban. The Highland Park case spurred a denial of cert, spurred a dissent from Justices Alito and Thomas, who walked through what Heller had said, and which was, you can't ban common arms, and therefore, while you could certainly regulate guns, you can't prohibit things that are typically used by law-abiding citizens for lawful purposes, to quote Heller. And the Highland Park ban was obviously flagrantly in violation of that. But for whatever reason, the majority of the court didn't want to take that case up. And like the other sort of main subject of cert denials has been on right to carry, where we've had cases from the Second, Third, Fourth, and Ninth Circuits, which have one way or another upheld the statutes of the or practices of the that minority of small now dwindling minority of states that are hostile to the right to carry and don't issue permits to law-abiding citizens who pass safety training and background checks the way the large majority of states do. And some of those cases have also resulted in dissents from the denial of certiorari, but that's the situation. The court's had lots of opportunity to get to do right to carry and bans on modern sporting rifles and standard magazines, and has declined the opportunity to take them.
Interesting. And actually, in a little while, I'd like to get back to that in terms of why this might be the case. But first off, Colby versus Hogan. Now, My layman's understanding of what I've read of this is that essentially they're saying that because the semi-automatic firearms are like M16s and militia-type rifles, therefore they're not protected. Would that be a fair statement?
Yes. Supposedly, the guns that Maryland bans are essentially the same as the M16 automatic.
Obviously, we would probably argue that because they're semi-automatic versus select fire. Okay, I got that. But correct me if I'm wrong, but when we go back to U.S. versus Miller, 1939, didn't they say that the type of weapons that would be protected are precisely the militia-type weapons, and that Jack Miller's shotgun, his sawed-off shotgun, wasn't protected because they didn't demonstrate it was a militia-type weapon? Am I right about that?
Or at least the way, it wasn't within judicial notice that was a militia-type weapon.
He skipped by bonds, I recall, right?
Well, right, and there was.
But the point I'm making is that the Miller decision claims that it's protected only if it is a militia-type weapon, and then the Colby decision is now claiming it's protected. It's not protected if it's a militia-type weapon. Is that right?
Well, that's right, and Heller, I think, puts a gloss and somewhat of a different reading on Miller, because Heller makes it very clear that machine guns are not part of the Second Amendment right, and you can argue that pro or con, and whether that's consistent with Miller, but in any case, that's clear enough from Heller. And so what the Fourth Circuit en banc panel did was take that point and run with it to a ridiculous, unsupportable length, and say that the Maryland ban applied to guns that are essentially military guns, although there's not a military in the world that uses one of the guns that Maryland banned. And as the cert petition from the parties themselves pointed out, the parties lawyers representing Colby and others, the Fourth Circuit's rule would have banned muskets in 1791, which... seems sort of as flagrantly contrary to the Second Amendment as you can get. I mean, according to the Fourth Circuit, in 1791, you could ban muskets and rifles and handguns, which were classically used by the military, and I suppose it would say that, a fouling gun might be part of the Second Amendment right, which is obviously backwards and ridiculous.
Okay, it's backwards and it's ridiculous. And by the way, I should note here, it almost seems like the Fourth Circuit, where unfortunately, it holds sway over North Carolina and us here, they're becoming almost as left-leaning as the Ninth. There have been any number of decisions out of the Fourth recently that have been antithetical to individual freedoms. I mean, do you see any of that? I mean, do you understand what I'm – do you agree with that?
Oh, I totally do, and it's not necessarily the Fourth Circuit has the like a lot of federal courts, unfortunately, a bunch of Obama appointees, many, not all, but many, of whom are just viscerally hostile to the Second Amendment, and then you can combine that with Judge J. Harvey Wilkinson, who is a very well respected long-serving Republican appointee who was also extremely hostile to the Second Amendment and to individual rights in general. He comes from that sort of 1970s mentality when supposedly what a conservative was supposed to do was to be against judicial enforcement of most of the Constitution.
Ah, I see. Okay, well, that's useful to have there. Okay, so now we had Colby. Now, there was also a case in Florida that was denied cert recently.
Yeah, Norman versus Florida. In Florida, Florida has a very good law for concealed carry permits and totally prohibits open carry of handguns. And the normal way judicial review of restrictions on enumerated constitutional rights is generally supposed to go, is the government has the burden of proof under what is called heightened scrutiny, and the government, there are different standards within heightened scrutiny, of which the two most famous ones are strict scrutiny and intermediate scrutiny. But either way, the government has some burden of proof to come up with some evidence to justify why this restriction is necessary and why some lesser restriction wouldn't be almost as good or maybe even or just as good. And so Florida's open carry ban really doesn't meet that standard. The legislative history is they just has essentially nothing to support the ban, and you're not supposed to. You may be allowed to think up evidence afterwards, but you got to have some starting basis in the legislative history. Nevertheless, that ban was upheld by the Florida Supreme Court in a pretty strained decision, and Steve Holbrook, the great Second Amendment lawyer from Virginia, wrote the cert petition, and the court denied cert on that as well. And I think that's, I wasn't surprised by that, because it, at least in Florida, you have a functional system for people to be able to exercise the right to bear arms. And at the level of Norman versus Florida, we're just arguing about the mode. And I think the more compelling cases were things like Drake versus Philco from New Jersey, where they have a licensing system for carry, but it's close to a never issue system. They do issue rarely, but it's certainly not something that a normal law-abiding citizen can get permanent.
Peruta in California, same situation. The Peruta case in California is pretty much the same situation, was it not?
Yeah, yes, at least for the jurisdictions that were in question in the Peruta case. California, like a lot of places, the licensing is county-based and it's by sheriff. So there are actually plenty of counties, maybe the majority, in California, where under the licenses are issued fairly to people who meet the background check and the fingerprints and then the safety training and everything else, and they want to carry for lawful protection. But there are definitely some counties in California where that's not the case, and hardly anybody except celebrities and their bodyguards and influencers get permits.
We're going to pick this up in just a moment. Again, we do have to take one more short break here. Folks, you are listening to Guns, Politics, and Freedom on Wilmington's Big Talker 106.7, WilmingtonBigTalker.com. Please join us after the break when we resume with our guest, David Kopel, and his read on recent Second Amendment Supreme Court developments. My name is Paul Vallone, and you are listening to Guns, Politics, and Freedom today on Wilmington's Big Talker, 106.7, WilmingtonBigTalker.com. Today we have as our guest renowned Second Amendment attorney David Kopel of the Independence Institute. Now, David, in many circles, the Supreme Court's refusal to take several recent cases is kind of causing a stir. There was an article in the Daily Caller, and it says, the High Court's silence has elicited criticism from diverse quarters. Dalia Lithwick, a liberal court watcher who writes for Slate and hosts the podcast Amicus, accused the justices of foisting a gun rights crisis on the entire nation, which they now refuse to solve. She wrote, We now know that we have a right and that it implicates our freedom, but the Supreme Court has left us to guess what the contours of the right and that freedom might be. So my question to you is, why? What's going on? I thought Donald Trump's appointment was supposed to solve this problem. Please,
Donald Trump's appointment prevented Heller from being overturned. He replaced Justice Gorsuch replaced Justice Scalia, who of course wrote the Heller opinion and was part of the 5-4 majority in McDonald versus Chicago and Heller District of Columbia versus Heller, and had President Obama succeeded in replacing Scalia with his preferred nominee, Merrick Garland, who was, by all accounts, a very able man and a really good guy in person. Garland's super hostile to the Second Amendment. And so likely Heller and McDonald would have either been overruled outright or greatly limited so as to be of very little practical effect. So that's what the appointment of Justice Gorsuch resulted in. It was we were on if the election in 2016 had gone the other way, we would have certainly lost a lot of ground on Second Amendment jurisprudence. The transition from Scalia to Gorsuch simply preserved the status quo.
Okay.
And that's all it could have possibly been expected to do.
Okay, fair enough. But yet that really doesn't explain why we were starting to make progress on the Second Amendment, yet now suddenly we seem to be stalled. Tell us a little bit about the dynamics of the court, why you think they might be denying cert in some of these cases, and what's going on.
Well, I think part of it is, this is just speculation, you know, Justice Kennedy is sort of our oracle at Delphi. And it could be that a lot of folks on the court don't want to take up a Second Amendment case because they don't know what Kennedy's going to do with it, and they'd rather stick with the status quo than risk a move in either direction. That is one theory. You know, another possibility is if you look at who has signed various dissents or concurrences on the cert petitions, you have Alito, Gorsuch, and Thomas all at one time or another. Notably absent is Chief Justice Roberts, who, you know, people always think of, okay, if there's a problem on the court in terms of the Second Amendment, it must be Kennedy. I'm not so sure about that. Kennedy was teaching the Second Amendment back at McGeorge School of Law at the University of the Pacific in the 1970s, when that was a pretty... he was correct, of course, but that was a pretty brave thing for a law professor to be doing in the intellectual climate of the time.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, and Chief Justice Roberts is the platonic ideal of the guy who has always colored within the lines and done so superbly and now sits atop the food chain. So it's possible he might not want to expend his political capital on controversial Second Amendment cases.
Oh my, how unfortunate!
Well, I mean, which means I mean he was solid on, you know, on the basics of saying there's an individual right, and just like most individual rights in the Bill of Rights, this also applies to the states. He was, I don't think, any problem at all on that basic thing. But in terms of, you know, the court's finite political capital, how much he wants to expend it on controversial 5-4 decisions, you know, might not be that great.
Okay. So it sounds, you know, like we need another Donald Trump appointment, sounds like. You think Ruth Bader Ginsburg, although rumor has it she will continue to try to serve after her death rather than have Donald Trump appoint her replacement.
Look, I in the Heller oral argument, I was sitting directly across from Justice Ginsburg, and actually in the Supreme Court, the counsel table is actually pretty close to the bench. I mean, much closer than in the typical setup in the lower federal courts where you're very far, you're kind of almost at the opposite end of the room where you're pretty far away and the judges are seated up there up far away like the Great and Powerful Oz. So she didn't look particularly unhealthy that day, but she looked, you know, quite frail, as if she could drop dead any minute. But that's what apparently she's looked like since about her 1930s. She gets excellent medical care. I bet she eats well, and you know, she's not going to win a you know, her age category in a triathlon, but I think she is in good physical health, all things considered, and although she, you know, she does look kind of small and frail, deep down she's got a core of titanium, and she's going to keep ticking for a long time.
Well, certainly I think she'll do her best to keep ticking through this administration.
Well, yeah, and that's common for judges, justices of all political persuasions.
Any other likely replacements?
Justice Kennedy is certainly getting up in the years. It's conceivable he might go, and obviously there was some signal that, people said, well, the fact that Scalia was replaced by Justice Gorsuch, a very distinguished quality judge, rather than, say, by Roy Moore, the former Alabama Supreme Court justice, was a in part a signal to Kennedy that if he does retire, there's going to be a good, solid replacement coming after him.
Okay. All right.
Although from Kennedy's point of view, I mean, Kennedy has said he's not an originalist. So, a Trump appointee is going to be from that Federalist Society, crew of originalists. So Kennedy would know he'd get somebody who was very good and might be on his side more often than not. But it wouldn't be Kennedy-esque, whoever the replacement was.
So it sounds like we'd have a step up any way you look at it, as somebody a little bit more solid for us. And in any case,
depending on one's view of solidity, yes. But if you're a Federalist Society pro-originalism guy, that would be true.
Cool. Now, when we set up this interview, you reminded me that our mutual acquaintance, Professor Greg Wallace at Campbell University in Raleigh, has a seminar coming up, and I believe you are one of the panelists. Is that correct?
I think it's open to the public, but I'm not positive. It's at Campbell School of Law.
Friday is, yeah. Thursday is not. Thursday night is not open. February 1st is not open, but Friday the 2nd is, in fact, open to the public, yes.
February 2nd, Campbell School of Law, and a day-long symposium on the 10th anniversary of Heller, which, of course, came out in 2008, with perspectives from me and lots of other scholars and lawyers on both sides of the issue.
It's
a very well-balanced presentation.
Yeah, I saw Joyce Malcolm. I've cited her works any number of times. I know Alan Gura and quite a number of other notable figures will be there. I think that'll be worth checking out. We'll be promoting that as the time approaches. I'm sorry. Go ahead, David.
No, it's great, and this is one of the nice things for scholars who work on Second Amendment issues is. Their work is of greater public interest than scholars who, for example, concentrate on civil procedure, important
cool.
that is.
All righty. I know I will be there. In any case, I'd like to thank you, David, for joining us today and for bringing us up to speed on the Supreme Court. Where can people find stuff on your work?
Go to my website, davekopel.org, DaveKopel.org.
DaveKopel.org. Excellent. Thank you very much, David. We appreciate you joining us today. Bye-bye now.
Thanks.
The world is a dangerous place. That's why we prepare to defend ourselves and our families. After we've won the physical fight, however, there's also the legal fight. Prepare yourself to win the legal fight with lawofselfdefense.com. Attorney Andrew Branca at lawofselfdefense.com helps educate law-abiding citizens to minimize their risk of prosecution and civil suit. He translates the legalese into plain English so you can make more confident, better-informed decisions when acting in self-defense. Now, for a limited time, you can get 20% off the legal education offered by lawofselfdefense.com using the discount code GPF at checkout. Just point your browser at lawofselfdefense.com/GPF. That's lawofselfdefense.com/GPF. You